Few now survive of the kind of farms that covered East Anglia in Seabrook's childhood 50 years ago. They were mixed farms with a variety of stock, and life went at the pace of the horse. In those days, farm workers were a large part of the rural population.
Poor old devils never had a wage increase for 20 or 30 years at a stretch. And I think the highlight of the year was the harvest in this part of the country. And my uncle reckoned they always used to go on down to the pub and get drunk, and then the wife was pregnant again, and this was the annual event.
Now they're gone, nearly all of them, and so are the sons sired after the harvest. The hedges have gone, and the wildlife they sheltered, and the animals that once grazed free in the fields. Farming in Suffolk has become big business, offering the remaining workers better pay, but seldom a better prospect than a lifetime on a tractor seat. Richard Seabrook was not content to work all his life as an employee, and more than 20 years ago, at the age of 30, he set himself up as something seldom heard of in these parts, a freelance worker, ready to take on short-term jobs for anybody.
Come on, boss, up to you. Here, come on up. How bad are the old feet then, do you think?
They're fairly bad, Richard. You want to go through them?
Yeah, all right, I'll go through the lot then.
Go through the lot.
And go through the footbath and we've done them. Yep. Okay, boss, come on up here. They're over here, aren't they?
Over that way, Richard.
Yep, go
in the pen.
I do a bit of this foot job, particularly where the farmer doesn't keep a full-time chap on the sheep. Come on, old girl. I'm looking for the ones that have got a touch of the foot rot. I don't go far afield after the job, but it is a job that fits in all right when the rest of the contract work with the sheep's a bit dead.
Very heavy, yours, are they?
No, please.
Good afternoon, Richard.
Hello, Pam.
I thought we'd have some sheep dipped, please, this afternoon, if that's all right.
Yeah, fitting time. I did the four old things. And
they're getting a bit...
I suppose they're as wild as ever, are they?
Yeah.
Hey, yep. Come here, Moss. Hey, bring him on, Mossy.
Hey.
Sit down.
Ferocious looking brute.
Don't knock his handlebars off. Too handsome for that, ain't he?
He's got his foot through it. He's got his foot through his
hand. Hold
him by the tail,
Julie.
Go on. Put him in.
Nice and wet now, ain't he?
Don't watch him, look.
The firewood job's another form of income added to the sheep enterprise. Last winter, we carted a tidy lot of firewood out. Some for a gift, and get people who keep an eye to your sheep for you, and that's a nice way of repaying them, look. Sometimes we take a few quid, we don't make a lot of noise about it, though.
Richard always had plenty of work in the spring, shearing sheep for people. It became more than he could manage alone, and he eventually got together the biggest shearing gang in East Anglia. Through May and June, they moved from farm to farm, working 12 hours a day and 7 days a week. In a season, they got through 20,000 sheep.
The best chap at the job is a fella called Ivan, and he can clip well over 200 sheep in a day. If we had a thorn in the gang, you couldn't carry on. You have to go at this sort of a job in a light-hearted sort of way. But, of course, the money is attractive to them. That's the thing that they come for, really. But we also see a lighter side of it and keep pulling each other's leg all day. When we really sort of get our backs against the wall and we've got a big lot of sheep that don't clip very well, this is what sorts you out, whether you can stick the pace or not. Besides earning a fair bit of money at the job, we do feel we're a service to sheep in this part of the country. There's no other gang of our size, and on a really hot day when you see the poor old things running away, just lost the coat, they do look highly relieved. They generally give a nice little skip or two just to say thank you.
With the earnings from his freelance ventures, Richard bought a house for his family and the 20 acres round it. At the same time, he was slowly building up a flock of his own. Over 20 years, it multiplied on such odd plots of land as he was able to rent. At one time, he had 8 landlords. Then he got the grazing tenancy at Ickworth Park, the National Trust land near Bury St Edmunds, which he still thinks of as an amazing piece of luck.
I used to shear the sheep there for the Bristol family, and that I used to think, well, it must be paradise to keep sheep in this lovely range of grass in there. Never ever dreamt I'd get my foot into it, and I went out onto a hare shoot once. My mate said, "Well, you're going to waste a day hare shooting," and the man said, "Look, we're going to give the old park up. Would you be interested?" And I said, "Cool, not half," and I got a relation with a bit of money to help stock it for a start, and we hired it. There was nobody else interested in it just at that time, and you know, this is the sort of thing you'd never dream of falling onto when you were actually messing about on about 40 acres.
The park had some drawbacks which a less grateful man might have made more of. It was 13 miles from home, which would have to be walked when the lanes were snowed up. Some of the land was boggy and would cost thousands of pounds for drainage. It was open to the public. Richard took the tenancy and prospered. His flock grew to 400 and at that point stuck for a while. What he needed was cash. It came in an unexpected way. His sideline in cutting up fallen trees boomed beyond all expectation.
Well, I had cut a bit of wood before I come to Ickworth, and then, of course, this was a hive of wood when I hired the grazing there. There was fallen branches under nearly every tree, and it was quite obvious to cut them up and flog the stuff, really, rather than just burn it up on site. And then the thing went on, and people obviously had got a liking for me wood, and the round got bigger and bigger, and Ivan's come in with me this winter full-time on the firewood, really, all winter. And then I've got other contacts about, so there's sort of almost a gang of firewooders sometimes.
Ivan Beavis is the first man to follow in Richard's footsteps as a freelance worker. He had long wanted to escape the boredom of tractor driving on a large farm, and the prospects in firewood helped him take the plunge.
No money actually changes hands between Ivan and I over the firewood job. He fills his van up so much every day and carts it out, so he's actually paid in firewood. Breeder helps us with the sheep and the firewood. Tough girl. She never takes any notice of the weather or anything, but she came along one year and kept an eye on the sheep when we were shearing 5 or 6 years ago. And she had a pet lamb that year, and she kept the daughters from it. Now, in fact, she's got 7 or 8 sheep, and that's the way she's paid. this jolly old paying out ain't the be and end all or everything. You've got to enjoy these blooming old jobs, don't you? You'd never stick to them, would you? Hello, Joe. Brought your wood at last. There's a bit of ash and a bit of oak.
That's all right.
Some of it I'll cut a bit shorter.
Yeah, that don't matter.
That'll be all right.
Yeah, that'll all mix in. Yep.
Customers are very particular about any sort of wood. It's either too green or too dry and it burn too quick or it's too long. Or since I've had this lorry, you finish up by breaking a manhole cover, or you knock an electric post down, or the worst thing I ever did was jammed a woman's dustbin flat up against the house. Go away, don't come on the place again. And then I had a drop of scotch and got a bit excited and dropped a bit through a very particular woman's greenhouse. And then, of course, the worst thing of all is a load of wood on the way home at night. And I'm very empty by that time, because we don't stop to eat much. And I very often get a strong scotch on the way home, and then, of course, when I get home, I just stop short of the front door one night, and I got me dinner over me head, in fact, when I went indoors. This is one area, I suppose there's 3 or 4 acres of this that we've felled completely. This was dead elm, and the farmer said we could clear this lot. So Ivan does all the felling. I haven't got very happy memories of cutting trees down. My first incident was I climbed a tree in the park once and actually cut off the branch I was on in a roundabout sort of way and fell 33 foot. Chaps like myself are best leaving these jobs alone.
Now, in February, the shepherd's year was beginning once more, with concern to keep the flock in sound health for the lambing season, which would start in 6 weeks' time.
This sort of snow business, we don't mind this so much as we do a heck of a lot of wet. These old sheep can put up with this cold a lot more than what people think they can. That's this feeding that's the all-important thing. You keep them with a belly full of the right sort of grub that they can put up with any amount of snow.
Come on up, in here.
These sheep that are away down the far end of the fold don't come up to trough at all. They're fresh down from the north of England last autumn time, and of course they're used to rummaging about on the hill lands, getting their own living, and they're a very tough sort of, thrifty sort of sheep to keep. They'll come up for a bit of hay if I dug them up, but they just scratch away in this snow and find a bit of grass, and God knows how they live.
Well, there was 30 of them that we had last winter. Tremendous good sheep, really. The 30 brought us up nearly 2 lambs apiece, and there was 10 of them never took any hand feed all winter. And really, we couldn't see any difference in the lambs that they'd brought up and the ones, our old Suffolk Cross sheep, which, of course, pack, grub into them and think of nothing else. And they, of course, haven't got nothing near this sort of hardy instinct these North Country sheep have.
Winter passed without losses to the flock and, thanks to last summer's good hay crop, without the anxiety over feed bills which had occurred in earlier years. In a few days' time, a new lambing season would begin. In 6 years, the flock had doubled to 900, and Richard had set about replacing the older ewes, a costly business which had absorbed all the profit from the firewood job and compelled him against his inclination to borrow from the bank.
I should get all the bags undone on there, Frieda. We'd better feed them in the trough to start with. So, you ready then? Huh? We want 2 of each, eventually. Pit afterwards. You go out wider than
I. Twice in the last 4 years, the lambing season had been plagued by abortions. A repetition this year would be a grave setback. March the 18th was an anxious dawn.
This is the first day of the lambing today, and we've made a reasonable start because we've had such a kind winter for one thing, and the grass begin to green up. Sometimes at this time of the year, the place is blue with cold and the sheep are worried gutting you all the time for food. And so I look to this year with the hope that I shall get perhaps 1,300 lambs, which I should be quite satisfied with. But every year, just prior to lambing, we have this touch of abortion. We've never had a year without it, and I should say pretty generally that most flocks of sheep have a few slip-ins. We've had 2 nasty old goes at it. 4 years ago, we had 220-odd ewes had premature lambs, and this cost me somewhere in the region of 8,000 or 9,000 quid at least in the terms of lamb sales, and so you don't want this to happen too often. So I'm hoping this year we've come through the worst period of time when we do experience it, and things look set fairly favourably for a decent sort of year.
Sit down there. Sit down.
Thinks you've got some complications, you know. Just a head here and no feet. Oh no, seems like you got 1 foot here and here. There you go. There I'll go.
Come on. Come on.
Go away, Mars. Get away. Get away out. Where you? Where you? Where you?
Among Richard's flock were a few sheep Ivan Beavis had bought with £200 left to him in the will of his old boss, an investment which he hoped might prove to be the basis of his fortune.
I have 10 sheep of my own, which I've bought this year, and I'm hoping that I shall get a few lambs out. I'd like something like a lamb and a half, which would be 15 lambs, but I had a bit of rough luck the other day. The very first sheep of mine, what lambs, slipped. So both the lambs were born dead. And I managed to find one of Richard's, which was lambed as well, the next day. And I managed to take a lamb off of Richard's and mother onto mine. And as a matter of fact, I let her out onto the meadow this morning and she's taken it, she's accepted it. So I've got one here with one lamb at the moment. And I'm hoping for a lot more.
Righto, you put the lamb in here while she can't sniff it.
Put it
alongside her, see if it'll ever suck. Oh, she's half interested in it. Working if you've got a pair of lambs, otherwise one will live and one will die for sure. Yeah, old girl, doing well.
So spring arrived, and the first week of the lambing season had gone well.
Come on up here.
As often when his anxieties are calmed, Richard looked forward to something he has long cherished but never yet had time for, to train a dog to trial standard.
Sit down.
Lost. That'll do. Stay there. Come on up.
The dog training side of the business requires a lot of time and patience, really, to train a dog up to sort of trial standards. This is a thing which I'd like to spend more time at, perhaps in later years. I got so I used to run a useful dog when I was youthful and steady. Well, now, of course, we take on all this contract work, and all this rushing about rubs off on these dogs in no uncertain terms. This old dog here, Moss, is a marvellous shepherding dog, full of character, but totally disobedient, really, but he knows the park, and we really couldn't run the sheep job without him. I took him out for a trial. I'm president of the East Anglian Sheepdog Society, as a matter of fact, and they say, come on, Seabrook, run your old dog. And first time I ran him, he belted off down the field and pushed the sheep into the stream and come herring off back to me and jumped in the water tank, much to everybody's amusement. Well, then the last time I took him out was up beyond Barry, and I said, oh, try your dog again. And the same thing, he went like blazes and brought the sheep right past them there, and they kept, look out, Seabrook. And they went right through the hedge and down the main road, and they finished up on the main Norwich railway line. So I haven't taken him out since then, but I've had several encounters. I remember once I came third in a trial at Cambridge, and they said, oh, Mr. Seabrook, third prize. And I was just going to strike up to get my prize, and a little man tapped me on the back. He said, here, what are you going to do? This dog's wetted all up my trousers.